We have seen different types of intervention to help animals in the wild, and also the kind of welfare biology research that can be done. We will now examine some especially promising examples in two different ways. First, in practice, to foster programs aiming at helping animals, and second, to promote further research on these issues, which in turn can make it possible for such help to be increased and become more efficient. We can consider several criteria for judging whether certain lines of research in welfare biology may be especially promising. The first is that it has the potential to raise interest among scholars. The second is that it has the potential to inform policies that can be carried out now or in the near future. The third is that it is likely to be supported by the general public. The fourth is that it has the potential to help a large number of animals. Finally, there is a fifth, extra criterion that is important but less relevant than the previous ones, whether it has been or is being put into practice already. In the long term, it seems that the fourth criterion will be the most important and that the fifth will no longer be relevant. Currently, however, it seems that the first three are more important for the purposes of developing welfare biology, and that among them, the potential to raise interest among scientists is probably the most decisive one. We will now see several topics in welfare biology that fulfill all or most of these criteria, which make them especially promising areas of research in this field. This doesn't mean that there can't be other promising topics, but only that these are very clear examples. We have already considered two of them. They are wild animal vaccination and rescuing animals affected by weather events. We will then consider two others that we haven't seen: helping wild animals in urban environments and helping large herbivores. These are all fields of research that both the general public and scientists usually support. Let's start with the advantages of doing research on vaccination. We already know that this is one way of helping a large number of animals. We also know that it can be considered quite reliable because it has been implemented for several decades and has been shown to have excellent results in saving large populations of animals from very painful deaths. Vaccination efforts have been carried out primarily for anthropocentric reasons, to prevent wild animal diseases from being passed on to humans or to domesticated animals. But they still have a very positive impact on animals. What's more important, that they are done for that reason means that there are important incentives to promote this research and to consider it a respectable field of inquiry in academia. This is a serious advantage. There's still a lot that can be done in this area of research. More work can be done to prevent animals from suffering from diseases against which they aren't currently being vaccinated. We can also learn more about the ways vaccination can indirectly affect other animals. In addition, we can now move beyond researching only diseases that affect human interests. We can try to influence new research motivated by a concern for animal suffering. Another promising area of research is about rescuing animals who are victims of weather events and taking precautionary measures to protect them. We have already seen that animals can be, and in many cases are, rescued from fires, floods, and other natural disasters such as hurricanes. Some people object to helping animals when they are suffering due to natural causes, claiming that we should only help when the cause is anthropogenic. This claim is problematic because for the animals involved, what matters is the harm they are suffering and not what triggered it. Besides that, the objection no longer applies now that weather events are changing due to human action. That makes related harms no longer purely natural, but partly anthropogenic. Because of this, and also due to the world's increasing attention on climate-related issues, helping animals affected by weather events has great potential to get more support. Some people are concerned that our efforts might change previously untouched areas in unforeseen negative ways. One reply to this is that we should study the ways in which this could positively and negatively affect the animals living in those areas. This is something we should consider when we try to help animals in any environment. There are also many ways to help wild animals that would not change untouched areas. This includes efforts to reduce the harms to animals living in urban, suburban, and industrial areas that are only partly natural and partly human-caused. Animals living in these areas typically include different types of birds, small mammals and reptiles, and many kinds of invertebrates. In some regions, they can include larger animals too. These are certainly not untouched areas, and while the ecosystems that exist in them are still complex, it can be less difficult to study the effects of our efforts to help animals in them than in wilder areas. Pilot programs can be monitored better, and their indirect effects can be more easily studied in these areas. This means that we can more effectively implement policies that reduce the suffering of animals in these areas, and what we can learn then can be applied to wild animals. This could be an excellent way of starting work on welfare biology. This particular area within welfare biology could be based on contributions from both the sciences of animal welfare science and urban ecology, and could be called urban welfare biology or urban welfare ecology. This research can be started by studying the ecological interactions that urban animals have with each other as well as with their environments. This will increase our understanding of what the lives of urban animals are like, the harms they face, and the ways their suffering can be prevented. Although this is not a topic that has been studied yet, there is already an important body of research that is relevant. Urban ecology is a well-established field. The population dynamics and life histories of many urban animals have been studied, as well as other circumstances that can affect their well-being, such as interactions with other animals, the factors limiting the growth of their populations, the way they are benefited or harmed by urban spaces, and elements in design. Some of these animals have been studied because their presence, at least above a certain number, is unwanted by human beings. Knowledge about this can be used in ways that benefit animals because of the existence of large populations of these animals may be negative not only for humans, but also for the animals of those populations themselves, if most of them have short lives where suffering prevails. A good outcome would be relatively small populations and where the presence of animals who tend to have better lives in these environments is favored over the presence of animals who have more difficult lives. One concern that may arise concerning intervention in the wild is that by helping some animals, we might harm others. Our goal shouldn't be to just help animals regardless of any indirect effects, but to look for ways of helping that can be net positive, considering all animals. To achieve this, we have to study ecosystems as a whole. In fact, eventually the best ways of helping animals will be at the ecosystem level. What we would look for isn't an improvement for a certain group of animals, but a scenario in which the overall proportion of suffering to happiness has shifted in a positive direction. We currently have what looks like a good example of this. There is currently much interest in the protection of large herbivores such as elephants. There are also important reasons to support this if we are focused on the well-being of animals. Elephants invest a lot of caring in their children, and they have high survival rates. This means they tend to have relatively good lives, containing significantly less suffering than most other animals. They also consume large quantities of plants. This plant biomass would otherwise have supported the reproduction of very large numbers of smaller animals. As we have seen already, these smaller animals probably tend to have lives that would include much more suffering, especially because they typically reproduce by having large numbers of offspring, most of which die, often painfully, shortly after coming into existence. Therefore, protecting large herbivores like elephants tends to improve the overall well-being of animals living in that ecosystem. Whether this is similar for other large herbivores remains to be seen. Studies on the way their presence affects ecosystems would have to be carried out on a case-by-case basis for large animals such as hippos and rhinos. The presence of other smaller herbivores like antelope or goats who don't consume as much biomass might also have a positive difference. The good news is that this is a feasible way that we can act to benefit animals. And we are already intervening this way, although with different aims, focused on the conservation of these animals. So we can see that there is much promising work ahead. In the short run, academically respected work will increase interest in this issue, which in the long run will maximize the expected positive result for animals in the wild. All this gives us reasons to be optimistic concerning the progress that the field of welfare biology can make from now on. There is another line of research that is very promising for the development of welfare biology, the study of methods to assess the well-being of animals in the wild. This can facilitate further scientific work that considers animal welfare when examining wild animals, so it is focused not on a particular way to help wild animals, but on a way to improve the probabilities of success of all others. We will see it next, when we examine the relationship welfare biology can have with other cross-disciplinary fields.